Who knows if there's a coronavirus pandemic happening by the time you're watching this video? But at the rate we're going here in the US, chances are you're still being asked to wear a mask. But let's face it, masks are annoying. They're itchy, they're hot, they don't always fit well, especially if you have a beard like me. Yet they're becoming a part of our everyday lives, whether we're out for a walk, hanging out with friends, or heading back to school. So, how much do masks really help? Unless you've been trapped in a small room for the past 4 months, oh wait, you probably have been, you've most likely heard that the US is dealing with the worst public health crisis we've ever had in the last 100 years. To help slow down the spread of the coronavirus, the Center for Disease Control and the World Health Organization now recommend everyone wear some kind of face covering in public. In the early days of the pandemic, these agencies and other officials recommended the opposite, which caused a lot of confusion.
Right now, people should not be walking. There's no reason to be walking around with a mask.
Part of the reason was that we didn't know as much as we do now about the coronavirus, so experts offered different opinions. You don't need to wear a mask. Well, even if you're not sick, you should wear a mask anyway. But they don't really help if it's not an N95 mask. No, actually, even a bandana can help to some degree. There was also concerns that there wouldn't be enough N95 masks for healthcare workers. And we don't have a mask-wearing culture in America like in Asian countries. This is a new virus that we've never seen before, so we still have a lot to learn. But as scientists continue to study the virus and how it behaves, they'll change their recommendations to the public based on new research. So now there's a clearer understanding of how the coronavirus spreads, and pre-symptomatic and asymptomatic transmission is possible. That's when you might be contagious but don't know it, and might unknowingly infect someone else. And if you're back in school right now, that could be one of your teachers. Or friends. But maybe seeing is believing. I talked to my buddy Joe Hansen of It's Okay to Be Smart, and his episode, How Well Do Masks Work, helps visualize how the coronavirus spreads through the air.
What's up, Joe? How's it hanging? How you doing?
I'm doing all right. How about you, Miles? You staying sane?
I'm staying as sane as I can. You know, some days are better than others.
These are weird times we live in. I don't have my mask on right now. It's like weird to look at myself without it on now. It's kind of strange. I'm just so used to seeing it.
Kind of just going into the video that you did on how well masks work. Can you kind of talk about like the motivation behind the video?
So I wanted to figure out a way we could try to make this real so that people could not just trust that masks were supposed to work against this invisible thing, but they could actually see it in some way. What we can do is look at what is making those viruses transmit between people, which is our breath. And we can see that using this really cool imaging technique called Schlieren imaging, which makes our airflow come out of our nose and our mouth like literally visible. It makes us look like dragons. It's crazy.
And at 250 frames per second, it shows us exactly why masks work to slow airborne infection.
And these are the kind of things that start to make this invisible protection a little bit more real and a little bit more like something that people can actually see inside of their mind.
And this microbiologist sneezed, sang, talked, and coughed over petri dishes. A simple mask blocked nearly all of the germs. And even though this experiment detected bacteria and not viruses, they both leave our airway in the same respiratory droplets.
Masks actually aren't a new thing. 100 years ago, the Spanish influenza killed more than 50 million people worldwide. Back then, businesses were also closed, gatherings were banned, and people wore masks too. But not everyone was on board with wearing masks back then, and despite the science, there's also been pushback in recent times.
What would people gain from wearing a mask, and why are you opposed to wearing one yourself?
Well, I just don't want to wear one myself. It's a recommendation, they recommend it. I'm feeling good. Maybe I'll change my mind.
Some people find masks uncomfortable. Others say they're an infringement on their personal rights.
Every week, social media lights up with videos of people resisting mask requirements.
I work for Costco and I'm asking this member to put on a mask because that is our company policy. So either wear the mask
or... And I'm not doing it because I woke up in a free country.
And there's some folks who believe that masks inhibit oxygen flow and expose you to carbon dioxide, which isn't true either. But that attitude seems to be changing as transmission rates of COVID-19 continue to rise.
We have experts that have said in the recent past that masks aren't necessarily good to wear. You know that. But now they've changed their mind. If they change their mind, that's good enough for me. So I wear it when appropriate.
Current data shows that kids and teens are less likely to get infected with the coronavirus than adults, yet there's still a risk. So chances are you're wearing a mask if you're back in the classroom. I chatted with pediatrician and public school teacher Emily Frank about what teachers and students have to face as they head back to school.
Why is it important for young people to wear a mask?
And so I know in the beginning of this disease, we really noticed that a lot of elderly folks were affected, but we're learning very quickly that young people are not immune to this disease and can get very, very sick or even lose their lives from it.
What is the current risk for, you know, younger people 18 and under contracting COVID-19 in the U.S.?
What it looks like is kids under 10 have about half the risk of acquiring COVID that someone older does. And what it's starting to look like is that children ages 10 to 17 have about the same level of risk as adults. There's some different theories about why that is. One thought is that younger kids have smaller breathing volumes, so when they breathe out, there's just not as much that they're exhaling or that it's closer to the ground. In order for the virus to enter the body, it needs to bind to what's called an ACE receptor. And these ACE2 receptors are located in our noses and in our lungs. There are some studies showing that younger kids have less expression of this receptor in their noses.
That's really interesting. And I mean, my next question is why have cases gone up then among like kids and teens?
In the beginning, when testing was quite limited, there's a good chance that a lot of kids had COVID and we just didn't realize it, either because they weren't having symptoms or because their symptoms didn't look the way we expected COVID to look. I think now we have a better understanding of how variable COVID can look in kids and more testing availability. So I think we're picking up a lot more cases than before.
I've been reflecting and thinking back like on what I would be doing like if I was a teen or if I was in high school and kind of just having to deal with what's happening right now. And one thing that like I would do or like that I've seen is like people wearing the mask improperly. So like what would you say to, you know, teens or, you know, students in the classroom that might try to take it off if the teacher's not looking or, you know, might not be wearing it properly because like we've been talking about it's uncomfortable or it's this or it's that.
There really is a spectrum of things to help keep people safe, and ideally we do all of them, and the reality is we will not be able to do all of them all the time. It's like thinking about safe sex. Abstinence means 100% there is no chance of getting pregnant. If you can't do that, maybe you do something with a 99% chance. If you can't do that, maybe you do something with a 90% chance.
So wash your hands, watch your distance, and stay at least 6 feet or more from other people. Perfect. And when you're outside, wear a mask. Be sure to wear it properly too, like this. Not like this. Or this. Or this. And what if you have friends who don't want to wear one? Here are some tips for encouragement. No one likes to be lectured. See this? This should totally be on your face right now. Come on, what are you doing? So be patient, kind, and offer gentle reminders instead to your friends. Hey, we should put these masks on before we head out. And give some facts about the science and let them know they're protecting their loved ones, especially those at risk. Use compliments and thank people when they do.
And jokes help. Happy social distancing.
And face masks are fashionable now. There are a lot of good options. And if you feel uncomfortable, just leave the space and make a point to walk away. That might help drive the point home that your priority is staying safe. And now we want to hear from you. How do you feel about wearing a mask in school? And if you have friends who don't wear a mask, what would you tell them? Let us know in the comments below. As always, I'm your host, Miles Best. Peace out.